March 9th of last year, around this time, I've been flying to Mumbai from Delhi. Exactly 1 year back. The next day, March 10th of 2012, I would be investigating a miracle in Mumbai, which turned my life completely. I've been studying a lot of miracles, lot of miracle claims, paranormal claims, a lot of these kind of things at different parts of India for several decades. But this particular miracle, which I could stop in one night, forced me to leave India, about which I would speak later. But this was the first time in my whole career of exposing and explaining scientifically the miracles of Indian holy men and gurus, I had to face a legal action, but that too in a very tricky way. There was no defamation case against me that I've insulted somebody, but they used a law that was made in 1816, which would not require a court's interference to arrest a person. The police officer can just arrest a person, cognizable, and it's non-bailable. There is one law like that, which is very, very rarely used. Last time it was used for convicting a person was in 1958. So again, it was used properly, but to silence me was the objective very clear. But I could not be silenced, they did not know. Because that was a small Catholic miracle in Mumbai, which around 1,000 people were visiting every day. And after my explanation, the miracle was over. But when I left India, I did not stop explaining miracles. I've gone to Poland, one of the fastest growing Catholic country in Europe at this moment. I've studied the local miracles there and explained it. Then when I went to Ireland, the Moving Mary of Battenspittal, which is a very famous miracle of Ireland, because a statue of Mary is all the time moving left and right. And people are witnessing. There was a BBC report about that thing. And I've gone there, put a laser point straight on the nose of Mother Mary, and put on a tripod, and watched for 3 hours and recorded the whole thing. The point was exactly on the nose and it was not moving. You know what was the, it was around the statue was a kind of a hollow like bush, and it was quite at a higher place, and on the wind the bush would move and one would have an optical illusion that Mary was moving. And nobody really wanted to study it so properly, and probably now the church would be feeling that it was a little dangerous that I've been taken out of India, because more and more miracles are getting exposed at different places. But I was speaking about flying from Delhi to Mumbai. But now I'm going to speak about the flying fakirs. There are a lot of people all the time thinking about people flying. For example, very popularly in the Christian mythology, there are flying angels. The whole concept of angels, not only in Christian mythology, but also in Muslim mythology, the malaks and jinns, also they fly. The angels fly. The concept of flying, very, very powerful, that was in any kind of civilization, you can find such stories. Or the flying witches. Very popular mythology. In the Greek mythology, there's a very interesting story of flying, Icarus. Icarus tried to fly in a very different way, as per this mythology. He collected a lot of feathers and made huge wings with wax, to fix it up, and wanted to fly to sun. Icarus ultimately made the whole thing, and he really moved his wings, as per the mythology, and tried to reach sun. And of course, the mythology's basic message was never try to reach the sun. Closer to the sun, the wax melts and he falls down. That's the message of individuals if they try to fly as per any mythology. But in Indian mythology, there is another very interesting flying machine known as Vimana. That's the word that we use even now for aeroplanes in Indian languages now. Here is a Ravana. The gods did not have a flying machine. This is the anti-hero. Ravana was against the incarnation of Vishnu Ram, and he steals Ram's wife and go away on this flying machine, Vimana. But of course, it needed some birds to carry it. But in Indian mythology, ancient Indian texts, there are a lot of descriptions how, for example, a flying machine can be made. Mercury, heated in a special temperature, could take the machine up, was the ancient concept. It's like alchemy, there was a belief like that, and it's written in text also. But at this moment, if you try, it doesn't anyway fly. But when Ravana, that's the story of Ramayana, Ravana has taken Sita and took his kingdom, and Ram fights a big war with the help of the monkey, soldiers, and they reach there and win the war, kill Ravana and come back. But during the war happens a big mishap. Ram's own brother dies. And there is one special medicine available in Himalayas. But how can it be collected? The god cannot fly anyway. But his supporter, Hanuman, the monkey-faced god, yes, he can fly. He goes to Himalayas, but he forgets the name of the medicine, where it is. He takes one whole mountain and carries it in his hands and flies back. And of course, then the correct herb was taken and the guy was revived. That's the story of Indian mythology's flying gods or supporters of gods. But nowadays, people are shown really levitated up. This is a famous South Indian guru who blesses his disciples floated on the air, but you cannot go closer to him. You have to get the blessing some 10 meters away. The problem is, he has a seat which is just fixed back and he sits on that thing. It's a very simple thing, and it's a hydraulic thing. If somebody pumps it down and down, then he goes up and up. It's very simple, this has been replicated by a lot of magicians on the stages. But there was another person. All this concept of mythological flying, right from Hanuman flying or Ram flying or in other mythologies people flying or angels flying, are all mythology, one could say. Or some kind of gurus just to attract some people trying to imitate something. But there was one holy man of India who tried to really make it a big market out of flying. You know, he started schools for levitating and flying. But not in India, but in Europe. And, there people have been flying. This is from the brochure of Maharshi Mahesh Yogi. His students in the flying school are levitating and flying. Real serious pictures. And in Switzerland, there is another school. There also people are flying. Yam Mumbai school in Switzerland, Maharshi Mahesh Yogi school. You know how they do it? It's a very simple technique. No photoshopping. At the time, there was no photoshopping. This was in 1960s. They would sit on spring mattresses, then hop up and up, sitting in the lotus position. And the cameras are fixed from the down. The moment they are spring up, photographs are taken, and next moment they will fall down with nose hitting down. That part is not shown to us. But with this technique and other techniques of flying, Mahesh Yogi could win a lot of supporters. And he was selling the technique of flying. You had to pay $2,500 in 60s and 70s to study to levitate. And you would really levitate. you know what you would do? You pay the money, register, and you get a personalized mantra for you. Not a default mantra, but specially for you. And one of the persons who have gone there has written later that he got a special mantra. It had two words only, Om Cream. Not the cream of milk, but Om Cream is a Hindu holy word. So what he has to do is he has to go down the cellar. There's a small room, dark room. He has to sit in the lotus position, which is normally very difficult for a European to sit. Most of the Indians would be able to sit like that. And it's very stretching for an inexperienced person. Sit in that position. Then you have to repeat this mantra a million times. Close the eyes and repeat it, and think that you are flying. And later it was found that before flying, before the session begins, they get a small eatery, which the Hindu, rituals, in Hindu rituals it's called as prasada. It's a little normal eatery with some sweets and all. So, complaint was that it had a little hashish in that thing. Okay, then when they go down and sit and repeat a million times Om Cream or some other mantra, they would really levitate, but others don't see it. And many people have said that, you know, they have levitated and went through the window and they have seen the city down and everything was perfect, and but others don't see, you know, maybe the only the soul goes out of the body and all, no one knows. But later experts have been explaining, and without hashish also this would work. You know why? If you sit in a closed room with less oxygen supply there, and you repeatedly chant any word continuously, you are exhausted at one side, and the lack of oxygen in the room provokes hallucination. Lack of oxygen is hallucinogenic. And without even hashish, if one repeats some word in a closed room so many, thousands of times, one could have such feelings. And we have tried. With one or two people, we have tried the same thing, but we have given a different word, just to say garbage. Garbage, 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 a million times. And you would feel that you are flying or floating or whatever you want. It's quite simple. But this is Maharishi Mahesh Yogi. He was quite charming for a lot of people and got a lot of wonderful devotees. The Beatles, for example, which gave him a lot of credence. And he made a huge empire out of this business. In Switzerland, in Amsterdam, he had huge establishments all around Europe and America and Canada and Brazil and everywhere. He died some years back. He did not fly, but he always said that what he was doing, the yogic flying or transcendental flying, was meant for not just an exercise, it was meant for global peace. India, he started in 1960s beginning. And you know what was the result? 1962, India had a war with China. 1964, one with Pakistan. Again, 70 with Pakistan and Bangladesh was coming. So in 10 years, with the global peace through transcendental meditation, brought in three wars. But who cares? So we tried to, imitate the flying in a very different way. This was me. I was not a holy man, but this is a National Science Center in Delhi. These are young students whom I tried to, I tried to educate them how to really levitate, not by hopping up, but really I brought one of the boys down there, covered his body with a bedsheet, and asked him to levitate. And, the boy has just gone up. Even his parents have been screaming with fear, seeing the whole thing. It's a very simple technique. I'll explain it later. But normally, holy men would do the same thing at many places. Most of these things are so simple, if you know. Here, the boy is actually not floating in the air. He was lying down, and when I say levitate, he would just go up like that, some 4 or 5 feet. What he does is very simple. He's trained. He lies down like this, and he has two hockey sticks in his hand. and he holds the hockey sticks, and here what you see is not his leg, but two hockey sticks. And he's just sitting with the head back only. It's little training required. And when this is done, all these boys and girls around and the parents could not actually understand. But I asked one of the boys to come and take away the bedsheet. And then when everybody laughed, I said, that's exactly what one has to do when somebody does. Go behind this scene and see what exactly is happening. So the National Science Center is one of the major campaign centers or education centers that we have. Every year, I conduct a workshop there for 300 students. And every student registered has one condition. They should go back to their school and train 10 more students how to do the same thing. Means 300 students I train means 3,000 students are trained every year to do all this holy man's trick. So these things are not more really working with the younger generation of India. But there are other gurus. Here is a holy man who is lying, relaxing on a nail bed. Imagine 1,000 nails, and he just with his naked body relax there. And you are convinced, because it's real nail, and if you put an apple on the nail, it would just pierce through it. And we tried if this can be done. Because explaining alone would not work. One has to show it that it doesn't work. And it has no magical requirement to do that thing. So we tried with so many things. First we made on a chair so many nails and asked somebody to sit. Well, I mean, people were afraid. Even our skeptic friends were so afraid to sit and try. But ultimately I could convince one of our volunteers to do that thing. And real long nails we made. And just he removed the shirt and did it. You know, it was so simple. When there are two nails or one nail, the whole weight is on that thing and it pierces into your body. When there are so many nails, the weight is distributed and it doesn't hurt your skin. Very simple like that, but one is afraid to try such a thing. When a holy man does it, one simply accepts it. And nobody wants to lie down on a nail bed. So this has been shown several times on the television and explained also. But the sadhus are, when they do it, you know, it's of great importance. They have a special status in India. Most of the sadhus and holy men or gurus or whatever they are called, they are respected. There's a set of sadhus who don't wear clothes. Naga sadhus, they are called. Nowadays, they are asked to live in a special place so that the public is not disturbed. There are thousands of them. Thousands. And they believe in one special kind of ritualistic life. And they think that a form of Shiva, one of the major gods in Indian belief system, is whom they are worshipping. And many of them go to the burial places, take the ash from there and put on their body, and make their rituals at the burial place. Human bodies are burnt in India for Hindus. It's not in a crematorium that it is done. It's with wood it's burnt. So there are special places for that thing, and these people simply go there, and rituals are done there. And a lot of people really believe that rituals done at the burial place has a lot of importance, and that can invoke gods or demons or whatever it is. And it can help you sometimes. It can destroy mainly the enemies. Most of the people are not interested in own well-being, but how to destroy the competitor. How to, if you have a girlfriend, and I mean, if she's also interested in some other guy, how can you damage that guy? These are the kind of things which these holy men normally work on that work, and they get a lot of money out of these things. Also, the concept is very interesting. If you do your meditation in a special position for a long time, you get enormous powers. That's the belief. And the whole Indian mythology is full of such stories. If you sit in a meditation for long years, then you can attain godly powers. Then the gods would send agents to damage your meditation. There's a very famous story that one of the gurus wanted to attain a lot of power, and he has started a meditation, and Indra, one of the famous gods in the Vedic period, was so afraid that this guy would be very powerful. He sends a beautiful lady from the royal palace of the heavens, and the lady would win him and take him out of the meditation and go back. So he stopped. Such stories are very popular. So many people really believe that strange positions, or holding the hand like this, or standing on one leg for so many years, would help you to get powers. But some people really think that one need not do such things, but one can just claim such things also. People could believe it. But most of these guys really believe that they have powers. And it's well known that the sadhus don't eat much, but smoke a lot of ganja. It's well known in India that they all handling narcotic products. But this is a special sadhu. His name is Pilot Baba. Pilot, because he claimed that he was a pilot in the Indian Army, in the Indian Air Force. And during the war in 1962, as per his claim, when he was flying over Himalayas, then he heard a special sound down there in the valleys of Himalayas. That was a sadhu. And he straight away landed the flight there and got a blessing from the sadhu. And he retired from the army immediately, and the air force immediately, and started the yoga business. So he got a lot of powers, and he says that he is Pilot Baba. And his major miracle, or major power that he shows, is he would get buried in water. He would sit in a pond, and water is filled in that thing and is covered. 5-6 days he sits down there. Or he's just buried alive with earth. He lives there. And when he tried this in Delhi some years back, there was a claim that he was remaining under water for 4 days, again for global peace. No lesser aims these people have. And when it was first announced, I've gone to this place. I was not very well known to the Indian audience at that time. That was some 20 years back. And I've gone there along with other people, and one of my friends, who was the correspondent of Telegraph newspaper in London, together we have gone, and Tim McGirk, and we have gone and verified the whole area, and found that there is a pond made of bricks and cement in the center of a park. It's 10 feet down, 10 feet width and 10 feet length, and he's down there sitting. But the top is covered with a tarpaulin. You cannot see. What he has done was, he has gone down first with the ladder, sat there, then the whole thing is covered. Then a big pipe was pushed into it, and in tanker trucks, water was brought in, and in public view, the water was pumped into this pond. Of course, he must be sitting in water. So, but I went to the place 2 times, and I looked at people who were working on this thing. I found the masons were working on this pond. One of them I could convince to tell me the truth. He said there's a small hole down there, which is connected to the main drainage. All what he has to done is, and it can be simply plugged in the pipe, and the water is not remaining there in the chamber or the room down, but it simply goes out. But he can put a valve there, and he can decide that water can come in also. For example, when it is opened, he can just block it and there will be water. So I knew the secret. How would I explain it? And I had a promise to this guy that I would not leak out his name. So I went to the media and I said that I'm sure that this Baba is not sitting in water, but rather he's sitting there and reading newspapers. So this was taken, the media was interested and they made a lot of stories out of this thing. And I challenged this Baba, if he can really go underwater and remain there for 4 days or 5 days for global peace, I would only want him to remain 30 minutes in a glass chamber, which I would organize in the Press Club of India. So he should just enter and do that, and we'll fill water, and everybody could see he's sitting in water. Because we requested that the tarpaulin is removed and we could take some photographs. They said, no, if the tarpaulin is removed and if there is some sound or voice or anything that reaches there, the meditation peace is gone, and global peace, what he is trying to achieve, can be damaged. So it's very dangerous threat. So I could only speak to the media. But on the fifth day, when he was coming out of this thing, then we went very early and found that fresh water is being again pumped. I knew why, because there should be water now, and he must be floating over the water, and he would come out. Yes, when it was taken out after 1 hour, he was floating over the water. Nobody saw him down in the water, but nobody was really allowed to come closer. So I could see that he was just floating only, and he just came out. Went to a high podium, and suddenly started a speech. Speech was very interesting. He said, some people don't believe that one could remain in water for 5 days. But they do not know that they have been remaining more than 9 months in water in mother's womb. If one could survive for 9 months, I could survive 5 days in water. But this person, he should go and ask his mother, then he named me. But very interestingly, he says, this person, then he says, Sajal, who made charges against me, should go and ask his mother. I was really surprised. My name was not Sajal, but Sanal. How did he make a mistake? Suddenly I remembered, Times of India newspaper has printed an article about my press conference. They made a spelling mistake. He was actually reading Times of India down there and got the wrong spelling. And, meantime, I looked at the pond and water was suddenly going down. I called all the journalists and showed them water was going down. This guy has seen me. He said, the rationalist is there, just kill him, he shouted. So this was expected, because I just went into the crowd, just vanished, and my car was waiting outside. The driver just pushed me in, and I straight away went to the Press Club of India and told the journalists what was happening. But by the time the journalists reached there, the holy man has vanished from the scene. He never came to Delhi for a long time. After 10 years, he again came. But not much announcement to the public, but to the media only. This time he was buried under earth, again for global peace. Iraq war is about to come, and he said the war will be stopped if he remained down there. And he has gone down. And what we could see was loose earth and nothing there. And over that some little grass and all are growing, and he's down there. So, of course, we could know that, he cannot remain like that. One can remain in loose sand, because loose sand would breathe. But solid land, it sometimes is difficult. So I've gone there, and this is a picture taken at the time. On here you can see a corrugated metal sheet. He was actually sitting in a room kind of thing, and this corrugated metal sheet was put over that thing, and then a lot of mud was put over that thing. And on the sides of this corrugated sheet, air was simply coming in. I went there just with some other friends and some television journalists, just took over this thing. And there we found him sitting down like this. This was taken. He was not buried like that. He had a fine mattress there and sitting there. And when the cameras came, he immediately went into this position. Otherwise, he was just relaxing like this. Anyway, the miracle is over, and Pilot Baba is no more doing this miracle, at least in Delhi. Nowadays, he's in Japan and doing it in Japan for the Japanese Indians. But some other yogis do other things. Like, here is another yogi with head buried. They express their powers in so many different ways to impress people. When you do such things, then you have great powers. Then you can bless people, you can get a lot of powers, you can transfer your power to other people, you can win a lot of things, and that would really work. People pay money to these people, quite a lot. But some people are little more clever. It's Satya Sai Baba. Famous or notorious god man. He has written an article when he was 30 years old. The article began like this. I am the god. I created this universe. That was the beginning of the article. Later appeared this kind of pictures. He holds the sun in his hand. And people believe such things. Really, I mean, it's not as fun, you know. Another thing that he would do is he would just move his hand like this, and then he would have some holy ash, vibhut. That's what Hindus who worship Shiva would put on their forehead. Just get this holy ash, and holy ash is what? It's burnt cow dung, basically, perfumed. And this ash he produces and gives to people. Thousands of people come and collect this thing. Keeps on producing and producing. But he did not know that later television cameras are coming and they could catch it very easily, because he started his business before television cameras began its job. And later, a lot of television cameras caught him red-handed. Some people found that he sometimes produces, with a move of his hand, say a golden chain, sometimes watches. I mean, especially for very powerful politicians and all, he would produce a watch and give, but not made by Sai Baba, Swiss-made watches. Sometimes, Citizen, that is one brand he normally used always. There was one story that the Seiko watch company, which was written by Dr. Bhagavandam, who was the scientific advisor to Government of India, retired and became the manager of Satya Sai Baba. He wrote an article that the chairman of Seiko watch company made a model which is to be released after 2 months and kept in his safe and visited India, and to, of course, visit Satya Sai Baba. And on visiting Sai Baba, he just moved his hand and gave him a watch. The prototype which he kept in the almara, lot, exactly the same thing he got. And he became a disciple of Sai Baba. Bhagavandam signed this article and published. And the rationalists and skeptics did not stop, and we have written to the Japanese embassy, ambassador, and got the address of the Seiko watch company, and the director of Seiko watch company, the name was correct. He wrote back, "I've never visited India, and we did not have a prototype kept in almara like that, and I do not know about this person, namely Satya Sai Baba." But this article was written and signed by Dr. Bhagavandam, who was the scientific advisor to Government of India. No explanations after that. But here is Satya Sai Baba. He had a special kind of hairstyle that was, the kind of people. On the left-hand side of Satya Sai Baba sits is Dr. P.V. Narasimha Rao, one of the former prime ministers of India. He was a devotee of Satya Sai Baba. And Shankardayal Sharma, former president of India, he was also a devotee of Satya Sai Baba. Sai Baba sometimes would produce in public meetings. You can go to YouTube and the secrets behind Satya Sai Baba's miracles. You get at least 100 video clippings now. He would produce, just while in a meeting, he would just make a terrible gesture that he has to vomit or something like that. And he takes a little kerchief and takes out his from mouth a golden Shivalinga. That's a phallic symbol. In India, the phallic organ of Shiva is worshipped by a lot of people. So he takes out a golden Shivalinga and shows to people. And it's so clear that he keeps it in a kerchief and brings it to his mouth and just take it out. And camera simply see it. Or he would just move his hand and take a golden chain, and cameras find that it's pasted down there, and he just take it out and show it. When the first video clipping of his trick exposed was found, it was not allowed to be shown in India. Of course, in Guru Bas days, the documentary that Channel 4 made about our work, we have given a copy, and it was shown in 27 countries, and it's all around available now. Also, that's available on the YouTube. But Satya Sai Baba, here on the left-hand side is Atal Bihari Vajpayee, then Prime Minister of India, and with the half beard on his other side, is the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, Chandrababu Naidu. So this is another President of India, Abdul Kalam. Abdul Kalam, very interestingly, was the topmost scientist. He was connected with the Space Research of India. Later he became a President of India. Abdul Kalam, on his birthday, when he visited him, wrote a poetry. Not good quality poetry, but of course, the poetry the word meaning of the poetry would be like this: the solar system is so blessed because the fine, beautiful earth is there. And this earth is so blessed because in this century, after all these times of its existence, Sathya Sai Baba was born. And that's the poetry. And this gentleman is not a small person. He was professor of aerospace engineering, first chancellor of space science technology, space science and technology, the 11th president of India, and Bharat Ratna, that's the highest civilian award that India would give to anybody. Only 5 or 6 people got it. Sad, but that's the ground reality in India. When Sathya Sai Baba died, sitting with this blue turban is the present Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh. And sitting on his left, the lady, Sonia Gandhi. Sonia Gandhi is the chairperson of the ruling coalition and ruling party, widow of one of the former prime ministers. And that former prime minister was the grandson of Jawaharlal Nehru, the first prime minister of India, who was an avowed rationalist and stood for scientific temper and insisted on scientific inquiry and critical approach. Times have changed. I do not know whether Manmohan Singh, who is a practicing Sikh religionist, and Sonia Gandhi, who is a practicing Roman Catholic, are devotees of Sai Baba. It's for political expediency, perhaps, they are doing this thing. But when they do this thing, it gives a lot of credence to the belief structure. And when famous politicians or famous businessmen, for whatever reasons, they go and give a certificate of acceptance to this kind of a holy man, that would go deep in a gullible society where people are willing to believe anything. But when Sathya Sai Baba's body was in public display, I've been in one television channel and I criticized this event, and I said I feel ashamed that our Prime Minister is there. And when Sathya Sai Baba was performing his miracle in Delhi, we could do in another television channel. When it is coming in some other television channels, I could appear in some other television channels and replicate the entire thing that Sai Baba would do. Produce Holy Ash, for example, I can also do. And I've done it and trained a lot of people to do it. Sathya Sai Baba has, you know, a lot of wealth. Not just wealth. He has an aerodrome of his own. He has a railway station of his own. And he has 18 hospitals of his own, including super speciality hospitals. He has a university of his own. He wants an entire village. So, what is that sound? Aliens? So, when he died, his private bedroom was opened and some strange things were located. And before that also it was interesting. Sai Baba had a trust, Sathya Sai Mission. His trust was doing all kind of work for him. There was only one trustee, that's God himself. The God himself signed all the checkbooks till he was 80 years. Then he had some Parkinson's syndrome problem. He could not find it. Then he took some trusted people inside, but watched. He kept the checkbooks with him and brought the checkbooks, and in front of him they signed and he took it. And he never allowed anybody to touch his money. He had a lot of money, and when he died, when his bedroom was opened, to everybody's surprise, one found that he was sleeping on a solid golden bed. Not gold plated, but real solid gold. And the top, the roof was studded with diamonds and pearls and very expensive stuff. The whole paneling was gold in the room. And under the bed, like in Indian tradition, one keeps a lot of some secret money for emergency situations. That golden bars, real golden bars, worth nearly half a ton. And in the almirahs were currencies, just bundled in gunny bags and pushed. And he was sitting in that thing and very happy was he. And he announced many times earlier that he would die at the age of 96 only, as God, he knew when exactly he would die. Repeated it many times. but he died at the age of 84. And when he went into coma, his devotees blatantly refused that he would die, because the god said he would die on 96th birthday only. But he could not survive, and I mean, of course, we have taken that also as a point to explain people. But they tried to make a lot of different calculations. Maybe he spoke about the lunar calendar. Okay, we calculate with the lunar calendar. Still, he would need 2 more years then. Then he said there was an Arabic calendar. He has been perhaps doing that thing. But this guy has never gone to Arabia. He has never gone to any other country than Uganda to meet his old friend Idi Amin. And that was the only country he has ever visited. So even in Ugandan, I don't know, there is a calendar existing separately, but nobody spoke about the Ugandan calendar. But anyway, no calendar was fitting in, and he died without his calculations correctly. But this is another famous goat woman. Sati Sai Baba never allowed others to handle his money. So many people who have been close to Sai Baba and who would know the market of this holy man, they normally would look for somebody who is quite easy to handle, who would not insist on signing checks, and they could handle the money. So some of them got an easy victim, namely the hugging saint, Amma. She is a special person, started her special way of blessing people by hugging them at the age of 15. The problem in her own autobiography, she comes from the state where I spent my childhood, and the language spoken there is Malayalam. And she wrote the book in Malayalam language, and there it is written that the family always thought, she told to somebody, because she cannot really write, she was an illiterate, she is illiterate. One of the books that was published about her, published by Penguin, The Black Madonna, there is a handwriting of the hugging saint is given. One sentence, I kiss you all my devotees. But 2 spelling mistakes in that thing. So she, in her own mother tongue. So that was her education. But she was invited, imagine, to United Nations to speak. She spoke in United Nations in Malayalam language. And what she spoke is not very clear to anybody. But there were others who translate her speech. Who were well-educated people, who spoke in wonderful ways, explained, and if one knows the original words that she used, like me, for example, I would understand the language because I know that language from my childhood. One would laugh and laugh. There is no connection with what she speaks. One of the speeches, she, for example, she was, in her childhood, many people thought that she's a little crazy. She herself has written it. Her parents wanted her to be taken to a mental hospital. 2 times they tried. The problem was, around puberty, she had a special problem. She wanted to hug any young man who comes nearby. It was not taken very kindly in a repressive society like India, because many boys were afraid and they ran away. She chased them and caught them, and if she could not get them, she would fall down and roll around and scream and climb on a tree and threaten to jump down and all, till the guy comes and allow her to hug. So then the family thrown her out and sent to some other relative's house. And then she started a special kind of, every evening she would just sing a lot of songs, especially devotional songs. Some days, on Tuesdays, she said she would get the goddess into her. Then she would make a cardboard crown on her and dance. And some other day, she would dress up like Krishna and then again dance. Of course, a lot of local people were interested, and they all came in the evenings and had a lot of sing songs and little dancing and all. And a young girl who makes a lot of interesting things for them. And so she would bless everybody by hugging them. And that went on like that. Then came some real managers for her. They made a mission in her name. Meantime, now she is around 57 years old or 58 years old. A huge empire she has made out of this hugging business. She has hugged at least 7 million people is what she claims, which includes prime ministers and presidents, not only of India, of other countries also. It's very easy. One of the cabinet ministers of India, who happens to be a close friend of mine, who is very progressive and rationalistic, once I suddenly saw a picture of him in the
I mean, hugging of this lady. So later I talked to him and asked, what was it? So there was a political discussion to be happening in the local area, and somebody said that it can be done at her place. And he goes there. The moment he reaches there, she rushed to him and just embraced him. And 25 cameras immediately clicked up the whole thing. And the next day it appears that he's just so scared in the hug. So that was how she gets a lot of photographs. And of course, here is one way of hugging. And very interestingly, one of the famous writers of India, Khushwant Singh, very famous writer, he's very old now, 97 or 98 years old. He was the editor of Hindustan Times newspaper, one of the largest newspapers in India, and Illustrated Weekly of India. Wrote nearly 50, 60 books. He is known as an agnostic, quite critical of all these holy men and holy women. He once went to Kerala. She was in her 30s at that time. Then he wrote an article in his famous column in Sunday magazine. He wrote that, I've not been believing in the powers of this holy man and woman. Never I believed. Then I visited Amma. And she blessed me with a huge hugging and kissing. I knew that she has great powers. And I believe in her powers. Next paragraph he writes, you must be wondering why I said that. At the age of 86, I had an erection in 2 minutes. And it was a complaint about her. Many people are telling that, you know, they said there's an erotic touch in the whole hugging business. But that's no problem for us. I mean, if she wants, if the other party is interested, I mean, who are we to complain? but when you give a divine touch to the whole thing, that your whole problems can be solved by such a hugging, that gives a wrong credence to the whole thing. Then she made a medical college recently. Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences. In medical colleges, to get admission to study for medicine is very difficult in India. Unless you get in merit in the government owned medical colleges, you have to go to private medical colleges, where you have to pay a lot of money, unaccounted black money, then only you would get an admission. And most of these medical colleges are run by religious charities. Most of these things. And Amma, the hugging saint, also has a medical college. And 60 lakh rupees is what we have to get there. It's around 10,000 euros, black money you have to give to get an admission there. I was told that there are nearly 200 seats every year. And the entire money is collected without any recording, totally black money, and it's collected and stored and used for other purposes. Then she collects money for a lot of things. When the tsunami was there, all over the world she collected money. But a special website in New Mexico, Ammachi.com, by her devotees in New Mexico, there was an article about her, why she should be given money. She has an ashram, 7th floor ashrams, and she was standing on the 7th floor when tsunami came. She saw the huge waves coming up. Then she took her sari. Sari is the long cloth Indians, many Indian women wear, and threw it to the sea. And it flew on and flew on and flew on and touched the wave and it stopped. That's why we didn't have tsunami effects on this part of the coast. So she could stop that thing. But nobody tells why she didn't stop the other side. Because it was coming from the eastern side and her house is on the western banks of India. So still, since India is, a corner like this, still the waves reached their place. And the walls of her own building has collapsed and 3 people died also. That is not spoken. But she collected a lot of money. Now there is a lot of complaints that this money is misused. It's not meant, it was meant for the poor people who lost their houses and, the whole wealth and everything. But most of this money was misutilized for building up her own institutions. Last year, government of India has stopped her foreign donations for misappropriation. But all the same, she travels all around Europe. Finland, I heard she was there, and there was a queue, very long queue of half a kilometer to get her blessing. In Spain, I heard she was visiting. Nowadays, the managers are very effective. They are trying to make small dolls of Amma. She comes every year in Europe. But if you cannot meet her, you can buy a doll of Amma and hug the doll. Now they are producing it huge quantities, I was told. This year onwards, you'll get it online also. Here is Amma with the plus this cardboard crown. And now she is in this form. She has a lot of Western devotees. These are politicians and all getting blessed. But not only Amma, but this is another very famous holy man whose name is Thirendra Brahmachari. Most of these people are doing all these tricks for global peace. But Thirendra Brahmachari owned a gun factory himself. But in the name of Shiva, Shiva gun factory. Shiva was one of the gods of India, god of destruction. He appeared on televisions every day morning in 1970s. And very powerful he was. He was connected with the ruling people at that time. And of course he died on a helicopter crash. And immediately appeared his nephew, Swami Sadachari. The word Sadachari means the moralist. Later he was arrested for running a warehouse. He would bless people, and some kind of blessing would involve some kind of body massaging. And there would be some ready people doing that thing. But he would take photographs of them and blackmail them and get money out of them. And one businessman was courageous enough to speak about this thing. There was a police raid and he was caught red-handed. Of course, Sadachari is in jail now because a lot of other misappropriations were found. There's another famous holy man who was the guru of P.V. Narasimha Rao, one of the prime ministers of India, whom you have seen with Satya Sai Baba. Chandraswami was arrested for misutilizing his connections in government, promising people to give licenses to businesses. That is what most of these people will do. When they try to give an impression that they have a lot of power, there will be a lot of devotees. Once you have a lot of devotees, the politicians are interested in you because that's votes. Once you have an access to politicians, that's a political clout. Then the access to politicians would give you a lot of other ways to collect money, like you would get favors done from the political authorities. And that's how most of these people were working. He collected a huge amount from a businessman who would produce, he had a pickle producer chain in the United States. He collected a huge amount of money, telling that he would get him a license in India, but he could not get it. And of course, was arrested later. There's another holy man, namely Asharam Bapu. Asharam Bapu, he dances a lot on the stage and cries a lot, and for all of your welfare, he would take all your pain and he cries on the stage. People are very happy. But later he was accused of doing black magic with human body parts. Because some of the black magics, as per Indian traditional books, need internal organs of little boys. And he has some schools, and some boys were killed there, found dead in the bathroom. And on post-mortem, it was found that their internal organs were missing. That's exactly these organs which are used for black magic like liver. So there was a huge complaint about him. The parents were struggling against him. But then came a picture like this. He was explaining one of the prime ministers of India, his innocence. No case, nothing is there. They are very powerful. Here is another holy man. His name is Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. Sri means something like sir. He puts two Sris because he's so important. Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. And he was a trainer or a teacher of flying under Mahesh Yogi. When Mahesh Yogi became very big, and he started, separated off from him and started his own club. But he was very professional marketeer. You know, he found a special way. He found that we all are breathing wrongly. How we breathe is really wrong, and there is a magical way of really breathing. And that is known as Sudarshana Kriya. The word he found it, and the special technique of breathing, he patented first, and then he made a trademark licensing for his name and started marketing.
He has been here too and sold his business. He's
yes.
doing business in this country.
Really?
Yes. They have an association in his name. You can find it on the internet, the Norwegian division of this.
Really? But in every city of India, on Saturdays and Sundays, public schools and all places are hired by these devotees, and people pay a lot of money to study how to breathe. And a person day can be taken by the local people, and the money is gone there. And then if you study the first level of breathing, then it's a second level of breathing, then you can have a higher session. And the third level of breathing is also there. Then you have to pay quite a lot of money. And well, people breathe. And then he has a famous theory, which is known as art of living. That's how he said it. The theory is very simple. Life is so wonderful, and one should feel happy and joyful. No objection. But how it should be done? Don't look at any miseries around you. Just don't look at any misery. When somebody is dead, don't look at it. Just dance around you. And when some mishap happens, when a train accident happens, he would go there with his disciples and tell people to dance. Sometimes people chase him off. It has happened in one place in Tamil Nadu after tsunami. He has gone to a village where so many people, hundreds of people died. He came in a huge Mercedes car, and the red carpets were thrown into the poor fisherman's village, and he walked over that thing, and huge sofas were made, and he sat on the seashore, and somebody made a little prank on him. They said, a second tsunami is coming. There was an announcement. He just stood up and ran back. Because that time he did not think of dancing, but saving his life, really. Quite powerful a person he is. He has politicians, top-ranking politicians as his friends, and he dances every time. He has a female voice and quite feminine movements, but a lot of devotees really take him very serious.
Yes, when he first came to Norway, he told the audience, "What do you want me to tell you?" I mean, that's speaking.
Yeah, he has a very special voice. If you don't see his face, I would say that, oh, that's a girl speaking. But very quite trademarked voice, of course. So here is another very famous holy man. His name is Baba Ramdev. He's not a small man. He owns a television channel and appears on 24 television channels every day morning and advises how to do yoga properly. He also has a secret of how to do yoga properly, and Patanjali yoga is what he says. There's a big chain of Ayurvedic medicines, and there are a lot of complaints about the contents of the medicine and the promises that they make and all. If you go to the internet, you can say what kind of promises they make about their medicines. But one major dangerous claim that he made was he could cure HIV infection with yoga. And the common wheat, fresh grass of wheat, chewing that thing, one could get immunized against HIV. Later he said, no, with yoga you can develop a lot of immunization. He makes a lot of claims, very interesting claims. If you go to go through a metro in New Delhi in the morning, you would see a lot of middle-aged ladies who would be just rubbing their fingers like this. Because this guy announces on the television that this is every part of our body, like acupuncture, he has something of that sort. There are some special capacities, and if you rub like this, you don't become very old. You will remain young. So once you cross 35 years, then you think of this thing and you start rubbing and rubbing in the morning. And especially when you travel in a metro, you see a lot of people rubbing like that. Or he makes special positions to protect yourself from ailments. And any morning you go to any park in Delhi or anywhere in India, you would see a lot of people sitting in very strange positions shown by Baba Ramdev. And one of the most dangerous things that I've seen was 2-3 years back when swine flu, H1N1, was spreading everywhere. Government of India made a systematic campaign to educate people how to protect oneself. Schools were told, teachers were telling students, televisions were speaking about that. Then Baba Ramdev came in the television He said that one need not make all these huge campaigns. One has to eat leaves of tulsi. That's a small herb. It is considered to be very holy by the Indian mythological texts. Chew this leaf and chant a small mantra. The mantra he instantly announced on television also. You know, instead of booking him for magical remedies advertisement, there's a law in India. The next day, the Delhi government, in a truck, collected a lot of tulsi leaf herbs and distributed free of cost to the people. Imagine. And he was, just 10 years back, he was on a bicycle in Haridwar selling Ayurvedic products. Then he started this special techniques of magical cure with his special capacities and got a lot of money. This is just 10 years back. Now he has a lot of money that he owns a huge chain of food products from United States to Canada to Australia, it spreads, and he handles several thousand millions of dollars of business every year. And of course, he recently purchased an island in Scotland with this money. So there, it's £2 million is the cost of this island, small island. There he started now a small retreat center for yoga. A lot of people are booking, paying a lot of money, and he personally comes and teaches there to do the yoga. Here is another yogi. His name is Prahlad Jani. He was very, very popular in television some 3-4 years back. 2 years back also again, he came back again. He said that he is not eating any food. At the age of 8 or something like that, some goddess appeared to him and touched his tongue. After that, he don't have thirst and he don't have hunger. And he don't eat any food. He don't drink not even a gulp of water. Imagine something around the beginning of the outbreak of the Second World War, he stopped eating and drinking and surviving still now. And nobody heard about him till recently, till one physician in Ahmedabad came out and said that I have a holy man who would not eat and survive. He has a special meditation power in him. So he suggested the NASA should study it immediately, because if this can be taught to astronauts, one need not take water and food when they go in space. It's quite expensive, quite a lot of fuel, because you have to carry all these things up. Then there was a claim that NASA has taken it seriously, and I mean, they're researching about him. We wrote letters to NASA and they blatantly refused. No, we don't know this guy. But government of India took him damn serious. The Defense Research Institute of government of India paid a huge sum to this doctor who claimed about him, and said that one should study it immediately and put him in observation for 10 days to see if he does not eat, but how he survives, the technique they wanted to study. And they thought of two things. Why the Defense Department is interested in that thing? On the high terrains of Indian borders, in Siachen and all, there are a lot of soldiers, protecting Indian borders. Food is supplied to them on helicopters, quite expensive. Food is dropped there. If they are all taught this meditation technique, no food supply is required. It's quite saving. So it's not joking. Government of India paid quite a huge sum to study about this thing. And he was put in a Sterling Hospital in Ahmedabad. And across there's a camera to watch him 24 hours, what all meditations and what all techniques he has. But the whole footage was not shown to anybody. One of the persons who have been working on this thing was a skeptic. He found that so many times every day he got out of the frames of the camera and then come back. And one nurse with her mobile phone took a small photograph that he sits in a small tub and pour a lot of water on him to cool down his body. And every time he opens his mouth and gulps in a lot of water in the process. So all pictures came out. There was a television program about him. All televisions have been speaking about this holy man with a lot of powers. And so during this first exposure of him, first time when the government of India tried this thing, I challenged him. I said, if there's an investigation going on, I would like to be a party of that too. I would not make any trouble for him, but I would like to watch it, see the records. For example, we would like to know whether he is producing urine, what's the glucose level in his body, whether it has up and downs. So I was not allowed. I got but the records. There was urine formed in his bladder and then disappeared. So we discussed about that thing. You know what the doctors explained? They said he must be having a special technique to recycle into his body. What's the technique? We do not know. But it's spoken seriously. I mean, absurd structures, but now this time, the second time when he was doing this experiment with this holy man, a huge amount was given by the National Defense Research Institute. I appeared in the television on 2010, and I challenged him, if he can do this thing in fraud-proof conditions when skeptics are there, well, we would accept that thing. Otherwise, he should pay back the money to the government of India. And also, we have full right to know how much money is given to him. But we have an Information Act in India. Anybody can obtain any information to pay its basic fee, but not defense research details. How much money is spent is not told publicly. So, but I know it privately how much money is spent from internal sources. It's several millions of dollars worth of money was given. It's not told publicly. And this person, Govindan Ilavadagan, the director of Indian Defense Research Institute of Ministry of Defense, and this Sudhir V. Shai on the left-hand side is the chief of neuroscience in the Sterling Hospital, who has been taking the initiative. And this holy man, during his investigation, I was in a television channel and I said that last time when this was investigated, I was not given an opportunity. I challenged them to invade either me or some other people who are skeptical in their approach or critical faculties are used by them to be part of the whole thing, and the record should be available. While the television program was going on, a came call from Sterling Hospital. Yes, Sanal Idamaru is allowed to come if he comes tomorrow morning. The channel announces, the Sterling Hospital immediately invites him and he is going tomorrow morning. So the television channel also will be going with me. Fine. The tickets are booked. Next day morning, 11 o'clock, I have to fly. 8 o'clock, there is a message. We need a permission from higher authorities because defense is involved in the whole thing. It's a research of defense, so we want a clearance from the Defense Research Institute. So one waits till evening, no reply. So next day we are told, no, the Defense Research Institute don't allow anybody to investigate because that will be jeopardizing India's defense securities. Well, of course, then we released the pictures that he was going out of the frame, then how he was taking water, and the records of his urine, bladder, urine storage, and then the blood glucose level going up and down, everything we released. And now, after the research, now it's 3 years, and no report is available to the Defense Ministry. No money is paid back to the Defense Ministry. And where is this holy man? No one knows. Because you cannot verify now if he's actually taking food or not. He's somewhere in Gujarat and in the custody of this the Sterling Hospital people. And millions and millions worth money of Indian defense has been simply stolen by showing this holy man. But Godman and holy men are appearing repeatedly. Satya Sai Baba has died and we thought, I mean, that's over. But this new Godman, Kalki. Kalki is the 10th avatar or incarnation of Vishnu, as people believe. He claims that he is Kalki. And his huge centers are coming up in Bangalore and Chennai nowadays. But some tantrics are really hard at a different level. This is a holy man standing on a little child 2 years back. I've heard this news and I've gone there, and this was taken from a mobile camera, and I could not stop him. His devotees were all around, and I immediately rushed to a television studio with his picture, and with the cameras recording the whole thing, we made a live television discussion about this thing, and tried to involve the local politicians, the parliament member of this particular district. This was in Bihar, in Katihar. The parliament, this is in YouTube, you can see that thing. The parliament member on phone live says that, I cannot interfere, because this is a matter of faith. Because when he stands on the children like this, and screams some mantras, they are immunized. People believe it. It's not in a village, it's a district headquarters. And just 2 kilometers away, you have a class 1 medical college where immunization is free of cost available to everybody. But still people do this thing. Of course, we got him arrested. The local politician, the health minister, everybody said we cannot touch its religion. But the national child welfare ministry, we could mobilize and got him arrested. We stopped it. But we campaign not only like this. This was 1995. This is the poster of one of our campaigns was when it was recorded by Channel 4. This is a young rationalist, not a holy man, replicating how holy men would eat fire. So we have trained a lot of people. In my workshops, I train people how to do this thing. One can really put fire in mouth and handle it. And we had a very interesting campaign in 1995. We decided to cover 100 districts of India, which included 1,000 villages. It took 1.5 years. Took off from work and other responsibilities, some 18 people. We have gone in a van, traveled districts and villages, talked to people, some 7-8 public meetings every day, a roadshow. Talked to millions of people, maybe 5 million is a general observation that we talked to, directly to people. And studied about their miracle, shown them how the miracle is done, explained them, and this was internationally reported. Channel 4 came all the way from Britain and traveled along with us for several weeks and made a 3-episode documentary named the Guru Busters. That was in 1995, and see, these are other programs that we try to do. I mean, we don't just explain people how things are done. When in a temple, people walk over the fire embers, we explain people that you don't get into contact with fire sufficiently to get the heat on your feet. No, it's not sufficient for people. They want to see it can be done without powers also. So we organize fire walking. And our young volunteers walk over the fire and show how it is done. And encourages people to walk over the fire and see that it's not hurting. Because when you walk over the fire without stopping, it does not hurt you. But if you stop halfway, look back and smile, then of course it's dangerous. So this is a part of our campaign which has been, I mean, not only fire walking, nail bed or anything that the holy man would do. What we normally do is, we don't just explain it, we replicate it, we show it and say that you don't need any powers to do that thing. And this is the scientific principle behind it. And you can do it. And if possible, we give a kit to people to do it at home. Or when we produce holy ash, we make small tablets of holy ash, how to keep it in the fingers, how to crush it, we explain to people. Then we hundreds of holy ash tablets we make and distribute it to people so that they can go home and show their friends how it is done. And also we tell how to make these tablets. So that next time when a holy man comes, children could simply produce and replicate things to them. It works. That is another campaign that we have. This is known as the Rationalist Reality Theatre in village. This is me personally there. One of our volunteers would go dressed up like a holy man in the morning. He would do everything that a holy man would do. Like producing holy ash or lying on the nail bed or, I mean, breaking a coconut and blood oozes out of it. A lot of things which normally holy men would do. And then the hyper gullibility is built up very fast. Then he would ask people to give him some donation. When they give a 10 rupee note, a currency, he would move in his hands, pray some mantras and give it back. It's a 100 rupee currency immediately. A small sleight of hand, which small magicians can easily do. And 2-3 times it's done and people are so convinced. Then he says that we have to make a new temple here. For that, bring all your money, gold, everything. Whatever you give will be replicated 10 times in your life. Women run back their home, bring all their gold and bring to him. It works so magically. People are so gullible. And that moment, in our program, one of the young boys or girls, 14 or 15 years, they come up and say that, look, whatever you're doing, just fraud. I can replicate the whole thing. And then the boy or girl would replicate everything that he has done. So there is a pandemonium and arguments going on. And you know, people are not, this time, suddenly we will realize, they're not fighting for the holy man. They're completely confused. Look with the utter unbelief, because how can we challenge the holy man? Maybe you have been thinking that this what he says is not correct. When he says is not correct, I don't have the courage to challenge him. Then this young boy or girl challenges him, they identify with the boy or girl. But that's a moment of conflict. That moment, the holy man would take off his wig and say that, I'm not a holy man. I wanted to show you how you can be befooled. You know what happens at that moment? Everywhere I've seen, people just burst into laughter. The conflict is over. Because the fear is taken out of them. That has been started, you know, we evolved. I've been directing a lot of theater plays and I got this idea and somehow we developed this thing. Every time we make a new structure, it's not replication of the same thing, but there's a new structure everywhere and people are improvising and making it different. But later, I've seen articles from famous psychologists in India, written that, you know, one of the major problems of faith is cognitive dissonance. If you believe that the globe is going to end on a particular day, if you are in a cult, you believe so vehemently and wait for that thing, and when the earth does not end on that day, you don't stop believing that thing. You don't feel that, oh, how foolish I was. No, you don't say that thing. You would more aggressively, with more assertiveness, you defend this faith further, because you have invested a lot of time, energy, mind. So you cannot go out of that thing. So you would want new reasons to justify your belief. So that's one of the reasons that reason alone would not be sufficient to counter superstition. When this cognitive dissonance makes a blockage, you cannot convince the person with arguments. But when this kind of a laughter is broken out, the fear is taken out, and that's a point where perhaps cognitive dissonance can be broken, is what later psychologists have written. We didn't know it exactly, but we are very happy to know that we have made a technique to break cognitive dissonance. It has worked very well. And I've seen that hundreds of people came out, and also out of these thousands of meetings wherein I've been speaking to hundreds of people directly about holy men, nowhere, but not a single place, there have been violence against us. We have been going to villages which are completely rampantly superstitious. Nobody countered us. People listened. And when they are taken out of the fear, there's a relief. Some people come and embrace us. And that's a very interesting feeling, you know. It's not that people are angry about us, but they are happy that they are taken out of the fear. Because fear controls Indian mindset, especially in villages, so deep. This is holy ash tablets being given to little children after teaching them how it is done.